Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Asian Development Bank's 60th Asian Impact Webinar, Digitalization for Gender Equity, organized in collaboration with the Gender Thematic Group of ADB. Today, we will focus on the economic impacts of accelerating digitalization and explore whether digitalization and technology can help reframe gender gaps in opportunity, access, and employment. We will discuss the challenges that call for collaborative action from policymakers, platforms, service providers, and development agencies, and what these different stakeholders can do to ensure both women and men thrive in the platform economies. We're delighted to welcome four esteemed experts to today's webinar. Joining us today is Yana van der Mühlen Rodgers, who's a professor in the Department of Labor Studies and Employment Relations in the School of Management and Labor Relations, and the faculty director of the Center for Women and Work at Rutgers University. Next, we will hear from Ming Tan, the founding executive director for the Tech for Good Institute and a senior fellow at the Center for Governance and Sustainability at the National University of Singapore. Also joining us today is Rachel Teo. Rachel leads Google's government affairs and public policy work in Singapore and a number of regional initiatives, including artificial intelligence, data, and sustainability, working closely with government agencies and civil society. And our fourth panelist is from ADB, Thomas Abell, the chief of ADB's Digital Technology for Development Unit, which promotes the effective use of digital technology across ADB programs to improve development impact. During the webinar, we will first hear from our panelists, helping us frame the current context for research, industry, and economic development perspectives. This will be followed by a Q&A session with questions from the participants. Please feel free to type your questions in the chat box, and we will be happy to address them and as many of them as possible during the webinar. If I may come to you first, Yana. You've been leading exciting research on women's labor market status. There's growing evidence that digitalization accelerated during the COVID-19 pandemic. How has digitalization affected labor market participation of women? Has the impact been all positive, or are there still areas to be addressed? Over to
you. Hello, Yesim. Hi, thank you for being for the introduction, and thank you for your work in organizing this excellent panel. So what I'd like to talk with you about is generally how online platforms can act as disruptors for the gender gap in employment. And then I'll be offering some evidence from a case study done in Indonesia with GoFood merchants. And this case study is based on a paper that I wrote with our esteemed host, Yesim Elhan-Kayalar, and our co-author, Yasuyuki Sawada. So in terms of an overview, let me talk a little bit about digitalization and employment, then the gender divide in online platforms, and finally, women-led businesses in Indonesia as a segue into the Indonesian case study. So what we have seen overall in the past couple of decades is increased digitalization. And that has contributed to enormous changes in jobs and the terms of employment for men and women. But at the same time, in the last few years, we've had another major disruptor, and that was the COVID-19 pandemic, which contributed to both some push and pull factors in terms of employment offered through the digital economy. So today I'll be offering some key themes on this digitalization and women's employment, and again, the case study. And the case study focuses on merchants who were considered MSMEs or micro, small, and medium-sized enterprises and their performance during the pandemic. So in terms of digitalization and employment, some background information. The gig economy and digital platforms are used to connect consumers and producers, and they are a very important source of job creation. But the research is showing that men tend to use platform work as a supplementary source of income, and women are more likely to do platform work as their only source of income. And study now after study is documenting gender pay gaps, also in platform work. You know, regardless of the feedback score or experience or education. Another big issue besides the gender pay gap is in many countries, including my own, the US, gig workers are being classified as independent contractors, which means they don't get a lot of legal benefits that other workers in the formal economy get. Yet on the flip side, a lot of work that used to be invisible and completely unpaid, like care work, cooking and cleaning, now can be monetized and scaled because of online platforms. There's a bunch of reasons and obstacles that women face that contribute to the gender divide in digital platforms. One is access to financing. Platforms often rely on formal bank accounts, and relatively more women than men are unbanked. There's also some obstacles that women face in terms of ICT infrastructure, especially lower income women in lower income countries. The cost of the phone may be too high, or they may have secondhand phones with limited reliability, or may live in area with poor Wi-Fi coverage, and they may have to walk or travel, and it might not always be so safe to get to digital cafes. Some studies have documented caregiving constraints that affect, for example, how far that women drivers may be willing to drive away from their homes if they have children at home, or the time of day or night that they are driving in the case of the driving apps. There's quite a bit of unpaid work that goes into getting set up and using digital apps, like searching, setup, advertising, and that contributes to existing gaps between men and women in unpaid work. Another obstacle is a relative lack of digital literacy or other skills needed to use digital apps, as well as what researchers are calling technophobia, the fear of the new technology. Some studies have shown that women ask for lower rates of compensation. They don't charge as much for the same work. And then finally, there's been instances documented of a lack of information on the benefits of how to participate in online platforms. So in terms of the case study that we did, and I realize I'm short on time, I'm going to have to go really fast through the case study. We looked at micro, small and medium sized enterprises in Indonesia. It's one of the fastest expanding internet economies in Southeast Asia. And I'm going to go a little quicker now because I don't want to use up the time from the other speakers. And what we did in Indonesia was to gather new primary data through an original survey where we surveyed, we surveyed 869 GoFood merchants in Indonesia. And we did this at the end of 2021. And we did phone interviews, and our methodology was descriptive statistics, regressions, as well as analysis of the interviews. Our first key result was that women merchants who were already on the platform before the pandemic were the most resilient group, and their businesses generated higher revenues than men and jointly owned enterprises. And here we see in the red dotted line was the gross merchandise value of those women merchants throughout the pandemic period. The second key result that we found was that the overall employment size of women-owned businesses shrank during the pandemic. Third, we found that women and men opted for different coping mechanisms, and women tended to be more inward-looking. As we can see in this graph here, women were more likely to cut back on their own food and leisure or even seeing the doctor, and men were more likely to not change anything. And finally, the key result, the last one and probably most interesting, is that we found that competition became more and more fierce as merchants of necessity joined the platform and did not do as well as the incumbents. So we saw a lot more competition over time as more merchants came in. So the policy implications are that digitalization did help businesses to weather the negative impacts of the pandemic. So digital platforms did highlight the key role that they were performing in building up resilience of businesses. But we do recommend that the algorithms used to define their service areas be refined so that this could help to resolve this cannibalization tendency. And in terms, this is my final slide, in terms of policy recommendations for women, we do recommend having more granular sex disaggregated data to better understand variations between men and women in access, more education and computer technology in schools, as well as more representation of women in occupations that heavily use ICT, and finally, better access for women to well-functioning financial infrastructures and mobile phone technology. So thank you very much. I will turn the floor back to Yesim.
Thank you very much, Yana. Thank you very much for walking us through the different needs, both for physical and digital infrastructure, as well as digital literacy, in order to continue with an inclusive development path, and that also that we have opportunities as digitalization accelerates and opens new gainful employment opportunities for women. We also have opportunities to mitigate occupational crowding, perhaps with women-led microenterprises in the lower wage jobs, and to help them move up the economic ladder as such. Next, I would like to come to you next, Ming. The Tech for Good Institute has recently conducted a poll and asked participants from Indonesia, Malaysia, the Philippines, Singapore, Thailand, and Vietnam, so six countries in Southeast Asia, whether technology and digital economy have delivered for Southeast Asia. Only 4 out of the 10 respondents agreed that it has. Is Tech for Good a foregone conclusion or still an open question? Over to you.
Thank you so much, Yesim, and thank you so much to Yana for the presentation. Hello, Rachel Thomas and everybody here at this webinar. As a founding director of the Tech for Good Institute, we wanted to get a sense of the general expectations of the tech sector in Southeast Asia, right, given our name. But before I tackle that 4 in 10 question, maybe I just say two sentences about our institute, because we're super young and some participants here may not know about us yet. So the Tech for Good Institute is a nonprofit entity seed funded by Grab. Our purpose is to encourage conversations across the tech ecosystem in Southeast Asia on how the promise of technology may be leveraged for sustainable, equitable, and inclusive growth for the region. So the poll that you cited just now, as you said, the respondents came from 6 Southeast Asian countries, and 46 respondents, 4 or 5 out of 10 responded, they agreed or strongly agreed that technology and the digital economy had delivered. And interestingly, almost 4 in 10 as well, 37% stayed neutral. And so I think this throws some light on the article that we have around this, throws some light on why this might be so. I encourage you to have a look at the article. The QR code is there, or visit our website, techforgoodinstitute.org. But I think one way of thinking about it is, despite or maybe because of the pace and scale and ubiquity of digitalization, many people are still waiting and watching, waiting to see if the benefits are going to outweigh the potential negative consequences. As Yana showed, there are positives and there are negatives. So at face value, Tech for Good is not a foregone conclusion. Technology has been the source of significant disruptions, shocks, and stresses in the economy and in society. But we believe it doesn't have to be this way. And because today's webinar is about gender equity, let me share just two examples on how digital technology and the new business models that they are enabling are helping to close the gender gap. So first, I'd like to introduce Shanti Lata. Shanti Lata is a health worker in Odisha, India. In 2017, she was working as a health worker. She was raising health awareness on issues like hand washing and diarrhea management. Then her 16-year-old son suffered a head injury. She sold all her jewelry and mortgaged her entire farm to pay for his treatment. But after surgery, he was still suffering from seizures, so he couldn't go to school or hold a job. And already in debt, she could not pay for further treatment because the doctors were in a city 60 kilometers away. But her son, in 2017, was able to remotely see a doctor via the IntelliHealth telemedicine platform. And over teleconsultations, the doctor was able to prescribe medication to manage his seizures, and he now holds a steady job. The next year, in 2018, Shanti Lata was trained to use the IntelliHealth platform. And today, she delivers comprehensive health services for her community. She provides health educations, does home visits, and facilitates teleconsultations with experienced clinicians in the city. And I share Shanti Lata's story because digital equity and gender equity is not only access to technology or a way to earn a living, it's also about the opportunity to use connectivity to participate fully in society and in the economy. So digital technology has allowed Shanti Lata to upskill and advance in her work. And through telemedicine, Shanti Lata is able to ensure that no one from her village has the experience of what her son had 5 years ago and not be able to get the care that they need. So for her, the mobile phone is a gateway to deepen already meaningful work and to increase her impact in the community. So I offer this perspective because I feel that striving for gender equity is more about helping women. It's about changing attitudes about how women are perceived in society. And so the question is, how may digital technologies increase the opportunity for women and also shift attitudes in society at the same time? And so let me share just one more example, because I know we're short on time, about mobility platform solutions and how they address not just an earning opportunity, but transport equity. So ride-hailing apps have been hailed as a way to reduce barriers to entry for women in work that is traditionally male-dominated. This is Suryati Binti Basra. She used to be a caterer, and then she started a PhD in education, and so she started driving. In her words, "I drive to pass time between class and to supplement my income." She has 3 kids in boarding school, and so when they come back for holidays, she has the freedom to drive less, and then she can spend more time with them. So like Suryati, many women identify the ability to work when they want as the key benefit to ride-hailing apps. And income and flexibility aside, ride-hailing is, I think, addressing a bigger issue, which is transport equity for passengers and drivers. In many countries, transport infrastructure and services underserve not just women, but also the poor and the rural populations. And as we saw with Shanti Lata and her son, the lack of transport meant lack of access to healthcare. So 10 years ago, ADB put out this report on the importance of considering the different transport needs of women. And I won't go through each different area, but personal safety was the key constraint to mobility, no matter where you lived. So there is no gender equity without transport equity. And in fact, this was the reason why Grab started in 2012. The founders, Tan Hui Ling, and her founder and her co-founder, Anthony, sought to solve the problem that women found it hard to get safe taxi rides in Malaysia. So let me share some digital innovations that Grab, but also many other ride-hailing apps have developed in response to feedback from drivers and passengers about safety. So there is number masking and chat functions so that there are never any personal details shared between driver and passenger. There is trip monitoring. So all trips are monitored to detect potentially unsafe scenario. If the driver goes off course or has to make an odd stop, The app will check in both on the driver's app to check that the driver is okay and on the passenger's app to make sure that the passenger is okay. Share My Ride. Passengers and drivers can share ride details with friends or family so that they can track their journey if they feel unsafe. There is an emergency button, one-tap button to go to the local police. And just this month, Grab rolled out the Audio Protect feature. If both the driver and passenger enable this feature through their safety app, the app settings, they can record the audio on their devices. As Thai driver Ranu Sirachampu in Thailand says, she likes the real-time trackability of the application, which means safety for both passengers and users. And we think about the layers of technology that has to go through to enable this. It's pretty fantastic. And so with these safety features in place, the women can provide other women more options to move about freely and independently. Excuse me. By the way, women drivers are also dispelling long-held stereotypes. In market where Grab operates, that's where we're able to get some data. Female drivers usually score better than male drivers. So access to health and mobility, these are just two examples of how digital technologies can further the goal of gender equity. But for all that I've shared so far, I must highlight that technology is actually the easy part. Whether or not tech is working for good is never just about the tech. Innovation is not about inventing a new technology. Innovation is about driving adoption and continued adaptation to improve technology to achieve the goals that we want to improve society. So I'd like to conclude this short presentation by coming back to IntelliHealth. This is Neha, and she's the founder of IntelliHealth. This is the telemedicine nonprofit that restored Shantilata's son's health and for which Shantilata now uses as a community health worker. While studying at Johns Hopkins University in the United States, Neha and her co-founders wanted to address the lack of access to healthcare faced by women back home in India. And in 2022, IntelliHealth served over 400,000 patients in three countries. So technology is not just the invention or the code. It takes a whole ecosystem to bring a technology to market, to motivate adoption, and to continually adapt and innovate. So in other words, Neha needs Shantilata and Shantilata needs Neha. So in closing, I'd like to propose how innovation and technology may be advanced for gender equity. First, we need women to identify problems, as Ling Tan did together with her co-founder with Grab. We need women to develop solutions, as with Neha, together with her co-founders and her team at IntelliHealth. And we need women who are keen to do things differently, not only to improve their own prospects, but to make a difference to their communities. As with Shantilata, as a community health worker, or Suryati and the other drivers providing safe rides to women. It is these women, not the technology, that are making gender equity a reality, one patient and one ride at a time. So thank you very much. I look forward to your questions and we would love to keep in touch with you. So please connect on LinkedIn or visit our website. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Ming, for that inspiring anecdotes, as well as introducing us to the inspiring stories of Shanti and Neha. And for recalibrating the bar to innovation and technology as conduits and gateways to better lives all around. Now, building on that point, Rachel, if I may come to you next. Digitalization and technology, as we've heard, impacts many aspects of our lives. And for a moment, if we could look more closely at the various channels through which an online platform works, what would we see? Can it or does it have an impact on gender equity, on creating more inclusive ecosystems online? Over to you, Rachel.
Thank you, Yesim. Morning, everybody. I'm Rachel from Google's Government Affairs and Public Policy team. I really first just want to extend a word of thanks to ADB for the invitation and also to the audience for being here with us to unpack a very important topic. For those who might be slightly less familiar with us, Google is a tech company that's responsible for many consumer and enterprise tech products like Search or YouTube and Android. And we'll touch on some of these today, like Maps and Translate. And I just wanted to follow on from Yana and Ming's sharing that we recognize that the role that Google has to play and wants to play in being a platform that forges toward that vision of tech for good. And I want to maybe expound on that a little bit. And first, I think the nub of this is our core mission, which is to organize the world's information and to make it universally accessible and useful. This guides our thinking around gender inclusive design in our own products and services, and also informs our approach to broaden accessibility for all by enabling ecosystems outside Google. Let me talk through first how we do this in our own products, and then I'll explain a little bit around the enabling ecosystems piece, which I think would fit very nicely with Thomas's sharing around infrastructure afterward. We do observe as well as you that the digital gender gap exists online and also in our products, and we do therefore have a very large responsibility to make a difference in this respect. I'll report toward gender equity online, and thank you, Yesim, for putting it in the website, underscores the framework that we use to think about closing the gender gap. That's access, content and community, and privacy and safety. The first one, access. Can women go online on their own terms? Typically, we think of access as the bones of infrastructure, cost, Wi-Fi, mobile data. Yana and Ming also talked a little bit about that. What we found in our research report is that access is also more than that. It's also the ability to go online when, where, and how a woman wants to. So this is about moving beyond infrastructure that talks about a woman's agency, mobility, and daily routine, which are also very important factors that determine their ability to go online. And this prompted us to develop offline access for apps that might have intermittent connectivity or difficulty accessing the internet, like offline maps, which was actually first developed in APAC and eventually has become a tool that has scaled globally. So that wraps up access, the first important point. The second piece, content and community. And Ming talked about how it's not just technology, but it's also about what technology enables, right? So can women find, create, and also share relevant content online that builds a much wider community than the one that they may interact with on a day-to-day basis? And we see that online communities offer women both emotional support and also niche information, especially for marginalized communities. We found that it was important through tools like Google My Business, or maybe more familiar to the audience as the little pop-up boxes that you see when you search on maps for cafe near me or on search. So businesses can identify as owned, led, or founded by women. And by enabling this women-led attribute on their profile, this raises the discoverability of their businesses, and it shows up on their listings on maps and search so that customers have more details to help them to decide where to go if I want to support a women-led businesses, for example. We also consider how we need to use inclusive design in our own tools to counter bias. And this one is maybe not so obvious to the public, but I thought it was a good example to show about how we need to remove gender bias in our machine learning models for language translation. So typically our machine our ML models are trained on big data sets that might have inherent gender bias, and these might be skew the future outputs of this model. So in line with Google's AI principles, we announced gender specific translations in Google Translate. For example, in a language where the subject is neutral, like translate, now offers translations that shows both gender options. So instead of subject is a doctor, that shows up typically as he is a doctor, in this case, it will show as she or he is a doctor. And that, I think, we want to show how machine learning needs to be de-biased so that we can promote a gender equitable society moving forward. So that's the second piece around content and also community in our tools. And finally, and certainly the most fundamental of this, do women feel in control of their online and offline identities? Do they feel like their privacy is respected? Do they feel safe offline? And I want to illustrate this in two ways. The first is through our community standards, which are the first line of our defense. It's an imperative part of our mission to keep our community of users safe when accessing our products through community standards. We remove content when we detect that it's violative or through self-reporting channels. This way, we filter out harassment, cyberbullying, nudity, and sexual content that unfortunately disproportionately affect women. And the second aspect of this is to build specific tools to keep women safe. And so one example is an open source code for a new tool to address online violence against women. We call this tool Harassment Manager, and we developed this with Twitter, with the Thomson Reuters Foundation, and other human rights organizations. It's meant to help women, public figures like journalists or activists and politicians, and other groups at risk of experiencing online violence to manage toxic language that might be directed at them by easily identifying and documenting harmful posts, and to be able to mute or block perpetrators of the harassment and hide harassing comments. Because we all know that once you've read it, you can't unread a harassing comment. So that's, I think, how, you know, just a couple of examples, and there are many more within what we do around how we bring our own products and services to bear in service of this greater objective. And the second piece that I want to talk about that, you know, really speaks to an ecosystem that's outside Google, but we do feel a responsibility to support that as well, to bring a wider impact and support the growth of women to benefit from the web by equipping them with digital skills. I think historically, our investment has been heavy in programs that encourage more girls to enter STEM, engineering and computer science, for example, like the Generation Google Scholarship to help female students pursuing computer science degrees excel in technology, and especially for underrepresented groups. However, I wanted to share an insight that we learned over the past couple of years. We realized that hard skills are critical but insufficient to increase gender representation. And we realized that women rank self-confidence as one of the top three skills most critical to successfully running a business in the digital age. This speaks a little bit to the technophobia that Yana talked about. And this informed our approach to inject education on leadership, communication, and productivity to our digital basics and tools so that women can feel confident to step into a digital workforce. Through working with the Asia Foundation and NGOs, we trained 200,000 people, of which 3/4 of them were women. And also through I Am Remarkable, another Google-led initiative, we've conducted workshops to improve self-promotion and motivation skills. And actually, we reached 300,000 participants, and over half of them said that it helped to grow their jobs and careers. So just wanted to give those few examples to illustrate. Let me conclude by adapting from a Maya Angelou quote. And it reads, "Each time a woman stands up for herself, without knowing it possibly, and without claiming it, she stands up for all women." And I would say that this goes for all of us here, men or women. Thank you, and I look forward to the discussion later. Back to you, Yesim.
Thank you very much, Rachel. Wonderful points, walking the talk indeed, and creating balanced access for both women and men online through skilling, empowering efforts for greater inclusion with access, content, community, and safety. Thank you. Thomas, allow me to come to you next. Digitalization of technology can provide and scale development solutions, as we've heard. And yet challenges remain, especially with implementation. And while digital transition appears to be moving forward across the globe, the development priorities and needs of each country may be quite different. In this context, how can development agencies like the ADB help?
Great.
Over to you.
And thanks everyone for joining. So ADB, of course, one of our 7 operational priorities is gender equity, and we build that into everything that we do. And also, digital technologies are transforming ADB's work across the board, even in traditional areas of traditional infrastructure. And so ADB has done a lot of work to drive digital in a way that's inclusive, including the gender aspects of it. And one, I would say, as already has been mentioned, foundational area is in connectivity access. So we know that in Asia, in our region, there's still about 40% of the population who don't have access to the internet. And that really is extremely exclusive. And women are actually excluded more than men significantly in the region. So we are trying, ADB's investments are very small compared to the private sector in this area, but we can make a difference by influencing policy and providing knowledge products and targeted investments that will help us move the needle in very important ways. For example, we see that the current telco business models across the world and across the region really are not geared towards serving the bottom of the pyramid. Those 40% unconnected tend not to have almost any disposable income to afford connectivity services or devices. And this is where government policies and innovations really need to bridge the gap. And we do find that there are possible innovations that can address this, but it's, you know, it really takes a concerted effort in both public support, knowledge, and policy, especially since the technology landscape is moving ahead so rapidly in connectivity. What even qualifies for adequate connectivity is always moving and becoming more, you know, more need for bandwidth every year. There are many opportunities here, and we actually have quite a number of engagements with our governments to support innovations. Another area where digital is making a difference is in social protection. We have a very strong program in partnership with our social protection group to bring digital social protection to many of our developing member governments. Digital social protection can level the playing field, make access to benefits more fair and equitable, and make tracking and understanding of the benefits more effective as well. And we even are supporting areas like including a grievance addressing processes within the digital social protection so that people can not only have access, but can have a voice if they feel like the access is not being fairly administered. And also digital social protection solutions can include, in some cases, even access to the technology, either through public services, public internet, or through subsidizing devices and services. The third area that we're very active in is in digital ID. Digital identification is especially important for women who are often excluded from government services and just access in general. We have a variety of programs across our DMCs to help implement digital ID in an inclusive way so that access can be universal. And then the final area that we have a strong focus on is digital economy and digital jobs, which has been obviously a big focus of the rest of the discussion. And I would add that an important area of this is the entire tech startup ecosystems. Asia is a very fast-growing economies, and tech startups are an important foundation to the digital economy, even though they tend not to be the largest industry, but they tend to create an unusual or extreme, increased momentum for countries that, that tend to be focused on youth and, high growth areas. And so most of the countries in our region are really trying to promote their own tech startup ecosystems. And we know that the tech startup funding across the globe is highly concentrated in a few areas like Silicon Valley or a few leading hubs, like in the region, maybe Singapore and Japan and Korea. We think that there's a big opportunity to expand investments in tech startups out to second and third tier cities and countries. And ADB has even launched ADB Ventures a couple of years ago to directly invest in tech startups. And the launch of ADB Ventures has built on the case that tech startup investments need to be more widely diversified. Right now, it's highly concentrated in the leading hubs and the leading industries, and important development sectors like education and health are underinvested. And ADB is trying to make a difference there, not just by directly investing, but also promoting policy and governments to address this. And I think we're seeing a lot of progress in that area. And this is another area where women are dramatically underrepresented, typically, it needs to be solved. Another area on the digital economy that's important to mention is that there's a really good example, which is the business process outsourcing industry. This goes beyond just call centers and contact centers, but goes into outsourcing of traditional business solutions like finance and HR and accounting. And there are some really good examples. Both India and the Philippines in our region are dominant players. And these industries are very effective in terms of gender. In the Philippines, the BPO industry is greater than 50% women, and that representation goes all the way to the top, that women are very well represented at even in the top executive ranks. And this is a highly growing field in the Philippines alone, 1.4 million workers, which have much better career prospects and earnings than traditional industries. And in some ways, compared to some of the gig economy type of careers, the BPO industry is doesn't have the I'd say ceilings of promotion. You really can easily move up from one job to another and make it up into management and executive ranks. So it's an important area to understand and how to diversify and bring those jobs into second tier cities and other other countries. And I think that ADB has an opportunity to contribute in that way as well. There's a great example we've worked with called Digital Divide Data that actually started here in Asia that brings high schoolers into the digital economy in these BPO type jobs and then gives them college education as well. So the digital economy can compete against manufacturing in bringing underskilled workers into the workforce, but then giving them a pathway to greater education and greater career opportunities as well, even more than traditional industries like manufacturing. And I think this this type of economic growth is what needs to be promoted more heavily. As we've seen in the Philippines has a significant number of overseas workers, people who leave their home country, go work in typically low-end jobs in overseas and get separated from their families. The BPO industry in the Philippines is now almost reaching the same level of economic impact as the overseas workers and has a much better impact for women and families and not creating the economic disparities that we see in when people are forced to work overseas away from their families. So I think this, it's just another example of how the digital economy can overtake the traditional economies of manufacturing and can be actually quite inclusive, both for, in gender and in other dimensions like disabled folks and reaching out to rural populations and et cetera. And I think that's the area that we at ADB are trying to promote, how to make the digital economy more accessible, starting from the basic connectivity access all the way through, to the other digital infrastructure and supporting all of our DMCs in, making this more available. Thanks, Yesim.
Thank you very much, Thomas. And thank you for bringing together some of the earlier points that have been raised by Yana, Ming, and Rachel about the importance of coming at this in a more holistic manner with digital and physical infrastructure, as well as some of the tools and services that the technology and digitalization can offer for social protection and entrepreneurial efforts. We have two questions from the floor. I encourage everyone to please put your questions in the chat box. We'll pick those up in the next segment. For the first question, allow me to go to Yana and Thomas, and the second one, I will come to you, Ming and Rachel. So the first one is, our audience member is thanking for the great presentations, Keiko, and she has two questions. What monitoring and evaluation is done to ensure that digital products and services are really bridging the gender divide and reaching women? For that, could I request very briefly, Yana and Thomas, for your feedback?
Let me see. I don't know so much about monitoring. Maybe Thomas can speak to that in the ADB context. Where I would come at it from a researcher, the monitoring would take place in terms of data collection. And that goes back to the point that you know, we've been emphasizing on the importance of collecting sex disaggregated data, because that's the only way we can really track what the gender gap is. It's with that data and then, you know, the analysis tools that we have in order to process the data. So I would say that this research is happening. It's an active area of research in all parts of the globe. And we are, you know, and it's very rigorous research, both the data and the tools that are available. And they are consistently documenting a gender gap. So, you know, I would answer that question from the research perspective, and it's ongoing. And this is where I think the research informs policy. And maybe then on that note, I'll turn it over to Thomas to talk about what the development banks are doing in terms of monitoring.
Sure, thanks. And you know, we leverage a lot of research from the GSMA and the ITU, and I think there is a very good understanding of the gender access to digital technologies and connectivity. Now, part of that is driven by mobile, because most of the incremental gains are mobile phone access, where that's often controlled by one member of the household, and many times that's the man. And we do need to see that households get broadband coverage all the way, including, you know, fiber access eventually, and to where the whole family can have equal access instead of having everything controlled through one or two devices in the family. These are going to be real challenges, but I do think that, you know, there's a wealth of data and understanding of, you know, who's actually getting access, and then, you know, government programs promoting equitable access. You know, I've worked even with the UNHCR on trying to get refugees access to connectivity, who are, you know, vastly underrepresented because, you know, they're in a, you know, much more difficult situation. And this is another area, I think, where, you know, there's plenty of data. It's really comes down to affordability and the fact that the current telco business model really doesn't allow them to serve, you know, very low-income populations.
Second question, which is, what advice would you give to tech companies in ensuring that gender equality is built into the design of products and services, how to overcome coincidental versus intentional gender benefits? Could I come to you, Ming, and then followed by Rachel, please?
Sure. Thank you, Keiko, for your question. Actually, I think companies really understand that women are 50% of their customer base, and, you know, an increasing, not yet 50%, but an increasing base of the employees. So they really understand how important this is, not just in the sales and marketing and the adoption side that I talked about, but actually in building the product, because a digital product, what goes in as input data determines what goes out. So it's really important that the input data sets are actually not biased to begin with. And I think Rachel actually talked about that a little bit, and she can probably give better examples. But, you know, the Tech for Good Institute is just completing a piece of research on what the digital economy companies today in Southeast Asia regard as the most important non-financial issue. Obviously, financial sustainability is important, but diversity, inclusion, and equity are consistently in the top three issues in all of the Southeast Asian six countries that we studied. So they know that this is important. But I think in addition to the product, it's really important to understand how the products are used. And a lot of the tech companies spend a lot of time understanding that. So for example, there is research out there that a woman is much more likely to have multiple users of her device, whether it's a phone or et cetera, compared to a guy, because, you know, the kids will use it for homework or to watch YouTube. So the input data that you get in on the user side is also different because it's not just one person, it becomes a composite. So understand, you know, making sure your product is is conscious and by design looking out for biases, but also being really sort of mindful in understanding your users and how that changes from location to location.
Great. Can we hear from you as well, Rachel, on this?
Thank you, Ming, for teeing up that very excellent point around sort of DEI and inclusion. I wanted to add a flavor of, on top of the example that I gave earlier around degendering the data, to talk about how we need to start even from fostering an inclusive workforce. And, you know, to give an example, I was quite positively surprised when I joined Google and realized that they degender hiring, for example. In our interview reports, we do not indicate she or he, we would say the candidate. So even from the get-go, you've got to degender the hiring process to take away any possible bias such that you can foster an inclusive workforce that brings about that diverse knowledge and perspective when building in the user experience journey for our products. And then you layer on top of assessing data sets for sources of bias, and you've got to train models to remove or correct for any problematic biases, and also even use machine learning to detect when there are inequitable performances and to test that system. And all of this, I think, is very much embodied within our responsible AI principles. Those have started not just at Google, but also it is much more pervasive across governments and also different companies. So I think it really starts from having a diverse workforce, the DEI portion, but also then thinking about how you translate that into your product and to be able to bring that perspective for the users. Back to you, Yesim.
Thank you very much, Rachel. Could I stay with you and also go back to Ming and perhaps Yana after that? Our third question, and very quickly, if I could request your initial responses to it. Our third question is, how can innovation and technology help produce gender-sensitive and inclusive statistics to inform policymakers and program implementers in identifying institutional and policy roadblocks to gender equality and digital social inclusion? Rachel, very briefly, and then Ming, please.
I think it's back to Yana's point around collecting the data. We have to, in knowing how our users use these products, are we able to inform the policymakers? I will also say that I think for consultative policymakers who actually want to have that dialogue with us around how we can mutually reinforce gender equity in our tools and products, but also in policies, is an important portion.
Great. Ming?
Well, I'll use a non-digital technology example, and I'll throw back that amazing ADB report. It's 10 years old, but when they went and looked at transport and they saw that actually transport systems have been built primarily to get people to work and back, right? Commuters into the city centers, but you understand how women are using transport. They do many multi-stops, they do shorter stops, they have to pick up kids, they have to care, you know, go to work, they also has to, you know, caregive. And then you realize that actually the data that you're looking at and basing your decisions on, if it's not complete, then you're not going to be able to find the right solution. So that example from the ADB report was fantastic. But, you know, at the same time, I want to emphasize that one set of data does not become one set of policy, you know, that it becomes the silver bullet to solve one big issue. I think that in an issue of mobility, for example, as well as in healthcare or in caregiving or in education or in any of these areas, which are the big gnarly problems of our time, it's that ecosystem approach and that many different solutions to be able to chip away at that problem in a coordinated way that can really make sure that we are able to cover both the first mile as well as the last mile.
Thank you very much. Yana, very briefly from your end, and if you could also share your thoughts on the next question, which is, are there still glass ceilings or any systematic hurdles for women getting promoted within the industry, because the tech companies don't seem to have many CEOs, women CEOs. Over to you.
Yeah, I think the first question was around data again, if I'm remembering. It was a long question, but I wanted to get back to one of the key barriers is women's unpaid work at home, and that serves as a barrier in several ways. So I think in terms of formulating policy, we cannot focus just narrowly on policy related to ICT infrastructure. We also need to think more broadly to the social infrastructure and supporting, you know, unpaid care work at home, because research paper after paper is showing that these unpaid work commitments that women have, especially childcare, you know, are a major constraint to their ability to engage in the digital economy and platform work. So that really affects policy. And I think both Rachel and Thomas spoke to the idea we cannot just look at the household, that you know, one cell phone per household is not going to indicate gendered patterns of use because of the sharing. We just like in looking at income data, expenditure data, we really need individual level data, that it just doesn't cut it at the household level. And yes, in terms of, you know, women's advancement into positions of leadership, again, one of the main constraints is, you know, this unequal division of work in the home. So I would really point to the importance of social infrastructure as well as ICT infrastructure development.
Thank you very much, Yana. Well, we're coming to the bottom of the hour and the end of our webinar today. If I may come for very quick thoughts in ending the session from our panelists, what are your final thoughts, takeaways, very, very briefly, please? Would you like to start, Yana? And then Ming, Rachel, and Thomas, please. Oh.
I think I just gave my punchline before that we shouldn't focus too narrowly on ICT infrastructure, that it's critical to take a broader look, especially at the constraints that women face that prevent them from using the digital platforms.
Thank you very much, Ming.
I totally agree with Yana, because the tech and innovation themselves don't solve the problems. Gender gaps are solved by a shift in mindsets, collaboration, and I think very importantly, and I know ADB knows this, political will. But we cannot take a build it now and fix it later approach. And I think what's really good is that digital economy companies realize that now. They realize that there is momentum to ensure that the development, deployment, and governance of technology should reflect the priorities and needs of society. But you know, we really need everyone, including everyone here today, to be part of this effort, right? Don't just build it now, fix it later. Let's build that ship as we sail, and maybe bring that ship to shore as well.
Thank you very much. Rachel?
I just wanted to summarize, well, also plus one to everything that Yana and Ming said. I think first, what is our own responsibility in this puzzle of gender equity? That's the first thing I would challenge us to think about. Two, how do we help a neighbor? What do we do that goes above and beyond? And three, I think the human aspect beyond technology is absolutely the right point that Yana and Ming talked about. Back to you, Yesim.
Excellent. Thomas, for your final thoughts.
Thanks, Yesim. Yeah, I agree with everyone as well. And I just want to emphasize that the digital economy is unlimited in potential of growth compared to the traditional economy, and also offers benefits for climate mitigation as well. And we just have to recognize that it has to be built out in a way that's inclusive, and it's easier to make it inclusive if we just make it happen. And that fact that 40% of the population, including more women and more underserved people, are completely disconnected today, you know, that's a problem that could be solved. And it's just gonna take the political will, and we just need to make it clear what can be done.
Fantastic. Well, thank you very much. We've come to the end of the webinar, and I'd like to thank everyone for their active participation. We've had some excellent questions and interesting points raised by our experts throughout the session. Before we close today's webinar, we would also like to invite you to join our next Asian Impact webinar on Asian Development Outlook, April 2023 launch, to be held on the 4th of April at 1 p.m. Manila time via Zoom. Until then, I would very much like to thank our external experts and guests, Yana van der Mühlen Rodgers, Ming Tan, and Rachel Teo, and ADB's Chief of Digital Technology, Thomas Abell. Thank you for joining us, and I wish you all a wonderful rest of the day.
Thank you.